Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. It is Wednesday Hump Day, August 2nd, 2023. Along with our producer and engineer, the one, the only, the wonderfully talented Mr. Aaron Zomers. Glad to have you along on a Wednesday Hump Day 2023. There it is. A little Geico Camel to kick us off. What better way to get things going? Appreciate you being along. Big show today, as we are the day after yet another Donald Trump indictment here. We will discuss that this hour. Just a few minutes with Trygve Olson. He is a senior advisor at the Lincoln Project. And then in hour number two at 2:30, going to change gears a bit. Doug Moe, a longtime writer and journalist in the Wisconsin, well, the whole state of Wisconsin, but in particular the Madison area. He's written for newspapers, for magazines. He is now with doing some writing for Madison Magazine. Interestingly, he helped write a book with former Governor Tommy Thompson. We'll ask him about that experience and more. Doug Moe in hour number two at 2:30. But right now, making a yeoman's effort. He could have just said, no, I don't feel like it. Number one, he's fighting a little bit of laryngitis. He could have said, no, I got other things going on. But Pat Kreitlow, you know, to put it in the layman's, he's a mensch. He's a great guy. Pat Kreitlow, host of Up North News, joining us not from up north, but from in the Milwaukee area. Welcome, my friend. And he is a self-described lobby lizard. Explain.
Well, you know, you check out of your hotel at such and such a time, and then you know, try to get back in. And you can get into the meeting room where you're doing your meeting. So I've got a meeting room full of my suitcases and briefcases, and I'm going to get a little work done before I hit the road back the 250-plus miles to Chippewa Falls.
Well, Pat, we appreciate it. And I know you've been struggling with a little bit of laryngitis, so I think it may be the fact you just need some of that Lake Wissota air.
Yes. I could not agree more. Switch microphones here.
No, that's fine. Maybe that would very good. Yeah,
help. I'll bet that helps a lot. Craftsman's only as good as his tools that he remembers to use. So I've been on the road for Up North News. We've been doing a little staff retreat down here in downtown Milwaukee. Mm-hmm. As you can see, reporting live. I've tried so hard to get a virtual background as good as yours, and I on minutes' notice after getting back from lunch, I just couldn't quite pull it off.
Well, you can tell you're a TV guy because you've got the background. It looks very nice. You can tell you're in Milwaukee there at the skyline behind you.
So. I know, but I didn't have time to put up my ring light. I didn't put on makeup. Wow. It's just not. It's not the same.
You don't
but
need makeup, for goodness sake.
Yeah. You're fine. See, now I say that to my wife too all the time. And,
I know if I had some TV makeup, I'd use it for the streams every day. Like, look how shiny my forehead is.
Oh, is that Aaron? I couldn't tell from the shine. I'm sorry. It's just like
I know it's blinding.
So, I am kidding.
Pat Kreitlow, not in voice, but he's still got it. Still got a little punch.
It's one of those where you finally feel better, but your voice hasn't caught up with you yet. Right. So. Very, very glad to be on the mend. It'll be good to head up north, head home again. But it is always nice to get down here. In fact, I just finished a lovely lunch date with my Tuesday and Wednesday regular guests, Melissa Baldoff, who does our weekly segment on the climate, and Joe Zepecki, who does our regular Thursday segment on state politics. Two of them are a thing, a couple, an item. What do we call this nowadays? A pair.
Sure.
And so we just had a lovely lunch here downtown before we headed up, and we talked about all manner of political speculation, if you will, because that's what we nerds do when we get together.
Big news of the day. I know you talked about it this morning on Up North News between 6 and 8 across to the Civic Media Network. The latest indictment of Donald Trump, and you and I talked about it this morning a little bit. Get your thoughts, reflections. For me, Pat, this is the one that hit the hardest because it literally is an attack on American democracy, or an alleged, I guess, if we want to truly use the journalistic term.
No, I mean, the courts can say alleged, and certain media outlets can say alleged, but we know what happened. Mm-hmm. We know from the January 6th committee what all took place. We've heard the testimony, not from liberal Democrats, but from some of Trump's closest advisors, some of Trump's family members who tried to tell him you lost the election. And yet he and others like Rudy Giuliani, you know, continued to conspire well after the legal challenges were done. And of course, in this indictment yesterday is, you know, the whole Wisconsin connection with the fake electors that got Scott Fitzgerald helped enable, and Ron Johnson almost took that fraudulent ballot to Mike Pence on that fateful day. So yeah, this is extremely serious. And while it is almost depressing that so many people still back Donald Trump and don't believe in the seriousness of this, I admit this is a clearly imperfect example, but you think of Martin Luther King, and we talk about what a revered figure he is now. Mm-hmm. And now we have this holiday, but I remember the very sharp debate over whether his birthday should even be a holiday. And then you go back even further when he lost his life, he was not universally loved. Yeah. Public opinion changes over time. And I don't think public opinion is going to be kind to Donald Trump when all is said and done, despite, you know, some of the people greeting this with a yawn on his side of the fence.
It's for me, it's a sad day for America. Yet another one. I'm not one of these that thinks we should throw confetti every time Donald Trump gets indicted, because I think it's a blemish on America. I do think it's great for the judicial system and proves that this system so far is working.
Yes.
Pat Kreitlow, yeah. Up North News every morning, 6 until 8. I really appreciate making the effort. Safe travels back to Lake Wissota. We'll hear you on tomorrow morning and get better soon.
I like that. Hey, you made the effort, Pat. Good job. I'll take my participation trophy and go.
No, I'll see you. That way.
I know. I kid. I kid.
Stay tuned for Trygve Olson on the other side. Thanks for joining us on the Todd and Ball Show. Pursuing truth wherever it may lead and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Mr. Aaron Zommer is on the board. It is 15 now past the hour of 1 o'clock. Glad to have you along. And it is a completely different time zone around the world, 9:14, where Trygve Olson, the senior advisor to the Lincoln Project, talk about dedication. This guy is on vacation and still making time for us. We really appreciate it, Trygve. Thanks for joining us from the EU.
Thanks for having me, Todd. I kind of just forgot to get her a substitute for me. So next week is somebody else going to do this.
Yes.
I'll get you somebody for the week after that. And then hopefully we're hanging out in Milwaukee.
We're working on that. It's looking like it's going to come together and happen. The Republican presidential debate, the first one, coming up here on August 23rd. We're making plans. Trygve perhaps be in town here with us and a couple of his other cohorts from Lincoln Project, and working on a special hour-long lead-up to the Republican convention on the 23rd of August. Really appreciate your help, as well as Lincoln Project's. Looking forward to that. But first of all, Trygve, breaking news yesterday while you were traveling and here at home, another indictment, yet another criminal.
Anything happened, Todd?
Right. <Yeah. laughs> Well, Slow news day.
I'll tell you what, when I landed in Frankfurt and I checked Twitter, I was like, wow, that's pretty big.
Yeah. And what's your reaction? Again, Trygve grew up, if you haven't joined us before, on Wednesdays. He's so kind as to be here every Wednesday and join us. We both grew up in Wisconsin, Trygve near the River Falls area in western Wisconsin. Both worked in Republican Party politics in Wisconsin. Trygve went on to work for national politics, international politics. We have both since left the Republican Party for slightly different reasons, but basically the same one, and that's we believe in democracy over party, I think. Is that a succinct way to put it, Trygve?
I think that's fair. I think I still consider myself a conservative in the Reagan sense.
Sure.
Not in the Donald Trump, what the Republican Party is today sense. There's nothing conservative about it. And I'll tell you, the response to Trump's indictment kind of gets to that end. I mean, I can't believe how many, not everyone, but how many Republicans have been trying to have this sort of both ways. Even Mike Pence, you know, say his name. Don't just say the former president. Say his name.
And this indictment, I'm not sure. I have not read every single page, but I've read a large portion of this and some of the analysis. I mean, this lays out in black and white, Trygve, that Donald Trump and the people closest to him were working diligently at the exact same moment that the United States Capitol was under siege, at the exact same moment, to your point, that there were gallows put up by Trump supporters on the lawn of the U.S. Capitol, and people had broken into the U.S. Capitol, running through the halls, yelling, "Hang Mike Pence," according to, I believe, the January 6th committee, that the mob came within 40 feet of the vice president of the United States. And this guy won't call that out. That's remarkable to me.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing, is that, you know, the American people have seen in living television with the January 6th committee most of this, mm-hmm. right? And in a very bipartisan fashion, at least amongst, you know, with two Republicans, Liz Cheney and Adam Kinzinger, who are willing to, you know, forego their political careers to speak the truth and mm-hmm. demonstrate immense courage. I think, you know, this is... I think if you had to rank the Trump indictments, and they're all stacking up now, I think this one and the document one are the two big ones. This one is about, and in some ways, this is as big or bigger than the documents. But at the same time, you have so many Republicans, particularly the ultra-MAGAs, who completely subscribe that the election was rigged, and even non-MAGA Republicans, like it's taken as an article of faith. So, but you know, in both cases, it's Donald Trump going at things that are cornerstones of American democracy, our intelligence community, and ability to protect ourselves, our elections. So.
And that's the thing, again, as you read through some of this indictment from yesterday, that it was members of the Trump cabinet trying to, well, infiltrate the CIA, the Justice Department, to not just, this suggests that Trump himself knew he had lost and knowingly tried to overturn an election, knowingly.
Yeah, and he dragged a lot of people along. I mean, even in the state of Wisconsin, right? Like right. You had these people who are part of what's talked about. I did read the entire indictment, mostly because I was sitting on an airplane from Frankfurt to Vilnius. And I was like, by that point, I'm awake. So I was like, right. Well, what can I do? I want to download this. I did read the indictment. I mean, you know, it gets into the fake electors in Michigan, Wisconsin, Arizona. You know, here's the scary part is, if Mike Pence would have gone along with it, it might have worked. So that's one thing. I think the next thing, and I said this on Twitter, I've seen a lot of people on the left. On the right, they're, you know, most of them are rallying to Trump or their mealy mouth and mm-hmm. their condemnation. On the left, you have a lot of people who are like, this is the end all be all. This is the magic bullet that's going to take Trump out. You know, I make the point, Donald Trump isn't playing that game. If he didn't accept the elections in 2020, he's not going to accept them in 2024. And we have to, after reading that indictment, he has to be defeated, not through the judicial system. And that doesn't mean that I don't think rule of law is important. He has to be repudiated by the American people. That is the only thing that is going to cure this. Because he is going to have a lot of people who stick with him. And quite frankly, if you look at the New York Times poll, you know, and the Marquette poll, they both show a dead even race with a lot of Democrats sitting on their heels. A lot of these voters in the middle, you know, Evers Johnson kind of voters in Wisconsin, not sure that they want to vote for either of them. And if you read that indictment, democracy is on the ballot. Joe Biden may be imperfect, but he believes in democracy, and no matter what Donald Trump and his allies on the right are saying, Donald Trump in multiple indictments has demonstrated complete disdain for democracy.
We talked about this last week, got a lot of reaction from this, and the Lincoln Democracy Institute is an offshoot of the Lincoln Project, of which you help run, and you did this fascinating you call it a poll, a research group, a focus group? What's the correct name to call this?
I mean, it's really research, because the truth of the matter is it's less a political survey. It's actually really using Question Pro, which is a big consumer research company. It's more consumer research on democracy, is what it really is.
And you interviewed 17,000 people. I want to make sure I say that again. 17,000 plus people over the course of a couple of months for about 45 minutes each. So this is not just a quick, you know, punch one if you agree with this type of poll. This is a research project. And what
here's what I'd tell you, Todd. If you were an extremist who watches a lot of right-wing media in Wisconsin, you were probably engaged for 42 to 46 minutes in answering questions.
And so the results, I feel that just bona fides the results even more. And you can dig down further into this. I'm just going to give the 30,000 foot thing. But what scared me, I'll use the word scared me or deeply concerned me after reading this, is to your point that, yes, I too believe in the judicial system. I think it was a great day for justice yesterday, but it's one step. And I think that in order for long-term survival of democracy in the United States of America, I think the belief in free and fair elections and the acceptance, to your point in this research project, the acceptance, even by those who may not support the eventual winner, is critical as well.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, it's funny because I was thinking of this when I got picked up by a friend at the airport. You know, I first arrived in Vilnius, Lithuania. I went to work for John McCain and the IRI. They asked me to come over here for a year and work on helping Lithuanians build institutions, electoral institutions for a presidential, the second presidential election that was ever going to occur in the country since Soviet times. Okay. Right. So, because they were occupied by the Russians. So I got here 5 years, basically after, in fact, McDonald's had not opened yet. It opened. This is a funny story. This is what got me thinking. We drove by the McDonald's by the train station, and the summer that McDonald's opened, it was really hot. It was the only air conditioned building in all of Lithuania. So everybody went to McDonald's for air conditioning. But I will tell you, we had teams. There were people from the American Bar Association working on rule of law and justice and helping them build a constitutional court. And there were Europeans here and others. I was working on elections and teaching their candidates and parties how to contact and interact with voters. They were building those institutions. Those institutions are built up over a long time. And yesterday, you know, our judicial system and the rule of law is strong. And what we saw yesterday is how strong that rule of law and the institutions are. But we've got far too many Americans today who don't trust those institutions. And the reason they don't trust those institutions are twofold. One is Donald Trump calling them into question as president of the United States from within those institutions, trying to destroy them for his own personal gain because he isn't playing the democracy game. And the second is, we have all these sort of allied forces, and you see this in the indictment, lawyers, consultants, right-wing media ecosystems. You look at the Fox News Dominion lawsuit, who are more than willing to lie to well-intentioned people and give them grievance that is imagined so that they believe that there's a two-tier justice system in the United States because Donald Trump is being prosecuted. Donald Trump's being prosecuted because he stole national secrets and because he tried to institute an insurrection. If any of us did what Donald Trump did, Todd, we would, if you tried to institute an overturning of Wisconsin elections the way he did, we'd already be sitting in a clink.
Yeah.
Right. Like we'd be in a federal pen. He is being treated. In fact, he is being treated more deferentially by our judicial system than most Americans.
I think that's an important thing, particularly for our more conservative or Republican listeners to realize that he is being afforded these, I'll call them special treatment because he's a former president of the United States. So that's important to remember. We're going to take a break. When we come back on the other side, I'm going to have asked Trygve, want you to help us walk through your experience where you are at in Lithuania, in Eastern Europe, and some of the tendencies you have seen over the years with authoritarianism over there, and how that relates to what's going on in America and why we should all be concerned. That's because I think that's really important to dig down in that. And also, Trump made a speech in Iowa. By the way, did you hear when they queued up the song "Only in America"? They queued it up at Governor Lake. She keep, I guess, had it queued up so that the line was "Some may end up in prison."
Right.
Instead of some may be president, which I thought that was kind of funny. But Trump said he's doing this for his supporters. I mean, to me, like a layman guy, that kind of sounds like an authoritarian. We'll ask Trygve, who's actually worked against authoritarians, what he thinks. Stay with us. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is 1:33. Our engineer, Mr. Aaron Zommer, is queuing up that audio. That was from the Trump rally down in Iowa last weekend. Governor Carrie Lake there. You can't tell me, Trygve, that her people didn't cue that song up to that line. And the look on Trump's face was priceless.
Oh, yeah. He's just walking up on stage. It says, one could end going to prison. He just stops and looks.
Right.
I mean, I thought
that
was fantastic.
I mean, that is the line. The idea that they cued it, that is pretty funny. It makes you wonder either they intentionally did that or some smartass who was running the soundboard decided that would be funny. I mean, I don't know that I told the take a chance on me story when McCain won at ABBA on the air, but
tell it because it's a great story.
For McCain, I was doing advance. Well, I ended up overseeing it, and McCain was unhappy about the music, and we were in Iowa, and he's like, I want something by ABBA. It's my favorite group. And I was like, okay. So when he came on, we played Take a Chance on Me, which apparently that was not the song that he wanted. I don't know if he wanted Give Me a Man After Midnight or like what, because there isn't really an ABBA song that fits that, but yeah.
This is the advantage when your boss is listening in. Civic Media President Mike Crude is listening. We appreciate it. You know, it only helps our ratings. And by the way, you can hear Crudy and Dom every afternoon 4 until 6 on the Devil's Advocates. But here's the kind of boss he is. He gave me a little a correction here. It was my bad. It was Governor Kim Reynolds of Iowa that played the theme song. I kept saying Carrie Lake.
All right. That is a great catch by
Crudy.
That is a great catch.
We appreciate that. Thank you.
And that actually changes the context a lot because Kim Reynolds, I know Kim Reynolds a little bit. I know her chief of staff or former chief of staff pretty well. Kim Reynolds is chair of the RGA. Then it was intentional because Kim Reynolds has flirted with DeSantis and anybody but Trump, but is still trying to stay on halfway decent terms with Trump. That was intentional. No doubt.
There you go.
No doubt. Whoever caught that, Mike catching that's a really good catch because that context wise, that's a lot bigger deal.
We thank Mr.
Carrie Lake wants to be Donald Trump's running mate, even though everything she runs for, she gets clocked. But Kim Reynolds is a serious governor. Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, so a good catch by Crudy. We appreciate that. I probably more interesting or substantive than the song was what Trump said from the podium that day. And this is what I want you to discuss, Trygve. Again, as someone who has spent time over in Europe, who has fought against authoritarianism in Europe, run campaigns against it, let's listen. This is just a cut now from Donald Trump down at this rally in Iowa last weekend.
Democrats, Marxists, communists, and fascists, indict me. I consider it actually a great badge of honor. I do. It's a great badge of honor because I'm being indicted for you. She's saying, that's good. Thank you. I appreciate it. And I believe the you is more than 200 million people that love our country. I believe that. It's 200 million.
So, Trygve, as someone who has experienced this in Soviet-blocked Europe, what does this say to you, language like that? There is an intention behind it, is there not?
I don't know. I think that speech sounded better when Pinochet gave it back in the 70s, actually. I mean, he could have given the, or Mussolini for right. that matter, in Italian. You know, the idea that, I mean, think about it. He's got all bases covered, fascists, communists, liberal mm-hmm. Democrats. Like, he's covering everybody but himself. It's classic autocratic move. It's classic, you know, we talked about extremism and radicalization on the show a couple of weeks back in our research. It's classic. So extremism and radicalized behavior tries to create others. Mm-hmm. They want everything to be us versus them, black and white. And that is a classic create others. And the others, what are the others? The others are, you know, Nazis, commies. And then he works in, you know, and then they're liberal Democrats, right? So right. he's lumping them in. There's us versus them. He does that all the time,
right?
Right? You're smart people. We're smart people. Those people who think they're so smart that you see in New York and on TV, they're not smart. Well, what's ironic about that? Who is from New York and pretty much made their bones on TV in terms of their politics? Right. But it's all about creating others.
It is the division, and this is the thing that I think is so fascinating. If I just remove myself, if I say I don't care about the outcome of the election, and I certainly do, but if I just remove myself, this indictment only makes Trump stronger politically. You have people coming out today saying, Marjorie Taylor Greene, I will vote for Donald Trump even if he's sitting in prison. This hardens mm-hmm. his base. And we've talked about this before. Mm-hmm. Somewhere between 35 and 40% of the Republican Party, they're voting for Trump no matter what. And I mean that, no mm-hmm. matter what. And
even if he's dead, they will write him in.
Sure, right. Immaculate election. But you know, I mean, the point is that there is a baseline out there. And as we move into this Republican debate, presidential debate coming up later, August 23rd in Milwaukee, which we are working on putting together a pregame show for, this becomes pretty scary pretty quickly because somebody needs to step up or a bunch of people need to get out if there's truly going to be an alternative to Trump. Yes or no?
Oh, I think the cake's baked, even if he were head to head. I mean, mm-hmm. our data, you know, we put it in there as kind of a question to segment, you know, a head-to-head between Trump and DeSantis, and it's pretty clear. And that was that when DeSantis was all the rage, and it was, you know, 63-37 Trump. I think the bigger piece of it is, Todd, and like you having run campaigns understand this, right? The box that Republicans have gotten themselves in, and the reason that they don't all stand up, and the reason that Mike Pence refuses to say his name, and the reason that Tim Scott, who by all other standards is like what you'd want your son to grow up to become, mm-hmm. but still, you know, wasn't willing to say it, is because they all understand this. It isn't just that Donald Trump has this block of 40% that are going to vote for him no matter what, and 25% of them are radicalized. It's that half of that 25%, so like, you know, 13% of Republicans to 15%. If Donald Trump's not the candidate, they're not voting for anybody. Mm-hmm. And so all these guys are trying to think of this in the electoral game that they know, which would be, okay, I get head to head against Trump, I beat him, but I don't end up saying something that precludes me from getting his support. The truth of the matter is that's baked in too. And the indictment only further hardens them on that as well.
So is it just kind of, they're going to have a debate no matter what. What's your sense at this point? Is Trump going to wait till the night before and announce he's going to come in, or is he going to skip this thing?
No, I don't think he'll go. I don't know what's in it for him. And honestly, if I were Chris Lacevita, who's running his campaign, who I know well, if I were Lacevita, I would be okay with waiting a while before Trump will eventually show up at a debate. But if he doesn't show up at this one, who are they all going to attack, Todd?
They're all going to attack Trump.
Are they going to attack Donald Trump?
Of course. If he doesn't go, I guess they flip a little bit to DeSantis, but I still think they're still going to attack Trump to some degree for not being there.
they'll attack him for not being there, but the person who's going to take the brunt of the attack is going to be DeSantis.
Right.
And so by not showing up, right, he's not going to – any votes that he loses for not showing up aren't going to come out of that 40% that he's got, right?
Right.
So by not showing up, what it does is everybody else naturally whacks away on his main rival. And I will tell you, the first thing you learn when you work at senior levels on presidential campaigns, do you remember that game Whack-A-Mole from when you're kids? Yes. That is what presidential politics is like. It's Whack-A-Mole. Who's ever going up, everybody gangs up on them and whacks them all. And then when they go down, somebody else goes up. And yeah, that is what it is.
I love it.
I think listeners would be amazed at how much teaming up goes on in backstage in the green rooms and beforehand, and sharing of, hey, you know, do you want to hit this guy? If I attack him, will you come in and pound him with this? And yeah, it's Survivor.
I think that's really, really interesting. And that's the kind of insight that we want to bring people on debate night here at Civic Media. So we're looking forward to that insight. I believe your boss, Rick Wilson, the Lincoln Project, may make an appearance here as well. It's going to be great to have him.
I think next week you should talk with if Stevens is able to come on, which is what we've talked about. You should talk with him about that. The real blocking and tackling of how primaries work, because Stuart's been through a ton of them.
If you have a call or have a question that is about political campaigns, feel free to give us a call. 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Talking to Trygve Olson, senior advisor at the Lincoln Project, and like me, a longtime Republican or former Republican at this point, 844-967-2789. Happy to take your calls. Trygve joining us from Lithuania, over in the in the EU. How about that? That's fantastic.
You know, Lithuania was just in the news because they hosted the NATO summit.
Yes.
And I will tell you, it is a big deal for people here because, you know, even back in 97, when I first came here, they were all like, how do we get into NATO? And the history, if listeners get a chance to travel and are looking for an affordable, really interesting set of places to go. I mean, and I've said this to a lot of people, head to Warsaw, Poland, go up to Gdansk and see where Lech Walesa did his thing. And it's a beautiful city. And then head over to Lithuania, go to Vilnius. You can go to the Hill of Crosses, which is a place where throughout Soviet times, people came and just started putting up crosses as a sign of protest, and then do Riga and Tallinn. And
sounds
then you
fantastic.
Can end in Helsinki, and it's easy to fly back and affordable.
And affordable. So there you go. Appreciate you. Yeah. A little shout out.
Cheaper than going and hanging out in Paris, of that I'm certain.
And probably, well, I shouldn't say more interesting historically, but as interesting historically, at least in
in
modern
for sure.
times. I have a caller.
Yeah, for sure.
I have a caller listening to us on WMDX here in Dane County in South Central Wisconsin. Let's go to Troy in Mount Horeb. Troy, thanks for listening. What say you?
Hello, I'm actually on the app.
Oh, very on the app. That's even better. Fantastic. Thanks for downloading the app. What say you, Troy?
They like to hear that you're on the app. So.
No, we do. We love both over the air and on the app. That's why I always ask the question. Go ahead.
Right. So I got a question. The last indictment in D.C., if Trump is convicted of that, would that is that the one that would keep him from being president?
Yeah, I believe so, because there's an insurrection charge.
The insurrection charge, I think, is the only one that could keep him from being
now
president.
Remember, though, that the standard of preponderance of evidence that has to be presented to a jury, and, you know, it gets into what was the frame of mind and all the rest of it. Like, for somebody to be convicted of insurrection, there's a very high bar, as there should be, because it's basically saying you're not a citizen anymore, and stripping someone's citizenship is really the ultimate you know, ultimate punishment that a judicial system can bestow on somebody.
But Trygve, correct me.
Bestow might not be the right word.
And this might be a question for, Matt Flynn or Maggie Dawn, attorneys. But I don't see how this case makes its way through the judicial system and goes to trial before next year's elections.
Mm-mm. Okay.
So I think to Trygve's point earlier, we have to go to the ballot box. We cannot solely rely on the judicial system. That's my sense, Troy.
And here's the other thing, Troy, you literally and people in Wisconsin are going to make the call what happens because
Wisconsin
is the cornerstone.
Wisconsin's ground zero. Troy, thanks so much. Got to go to a break. Troy from Mount Horeb on the app. We appreciate you. Lou and Cudahy, hang on. We'll take your call after this. This is the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Dangerous, Mr. Summers, trolling all the way across the sea. This is the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. A little Katy Perry for Trygve Olson from Lincoln Project.
You know, it's been a while since I've done that.
It's been a while. So his kids love it. His daughters love it. Welcome back to the show, the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. And it's now 10 before the hour of 2 o'clock. If you'd like to chime in, always happy to have you on the phone lines as per usual. And on the Twitter, on the app as well. You can text in anytime, anywhere on the app or give us a call, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Let's go to Cudahy, beautiful Cudahy, and Lou has been on the hold. Lou, what say you?
One of the reasons you're on the air is to be propagandists and take the attention of the American people off the corruption of the Biden administration, where they use federal agencies to go after, they weaponize them to go after the political enemies. That's great. I appreciate that. America sees that.
Do you have a question,
Representative
Lou?
What's your
question, Lou?
Mace, I'll tell you. Representative Nancy Mace from, I think she's from Pennsylvania, she's a Republican, has seen evidence that has Biden now receiving up to $10 million from the Chinese. What do you think about that?
All right, thanks for the call, question. Lou. Appreciate it. Trygve, what say you?
Well, first of all, Nancy Mace is from South Carolina. She's a graduate of the Citadel. She has... I think she's kind of actually been a Republican who's kind of balanced things both ways. She didn't vote for impeachment, but she was pretty critical of. I think she voted for the January 6th committee.
All right.
Here's my question to Lou, though. Which Republicans exactly does he know, that the so-called weaponized Justice Department is going after? And, this is the thing, Lou. You have people in Donald Trump and a lot of the people around him who, if you've been giving money because you were concerned about election fraud, that has been going to defend himself and his legal fees. But not only that, it's been going and paying for a stylist for Melania, upwards of $1 million. It's been going to pay for his aide, Jason Miller, who you may see on Fox News regularly, to pay for his child support case because he wasn't paying child support to a woman who he got pregnant during the campaign and refused to acknowledge that it was his child until there was a paternity test. Those are the things that you're paying for. And oh, by the way, if you bought a Trump yard sign, you weren't donating the money the way that it was during George Bush's administration. Where it went to a vendor where most of that money went back into the process, you were donating your money to that ultimately the signs were provided by an LLC that more likely than not was owned by guess who, Lou? Donald Trump. So the reality is it's unfortunate, I think we are critical of President Biden when there are needs to. We certainly have been critical. We have pointed out good things that we thought Republicans are doing in the state of Wisconsin. So, like around the idea that colleges should, you know, kids who are in the top 5% should be automatically admitted to Wisconsin universities. But yeah, Lou, I feel bad because much like my friends in back home who have gone all in on Trump, part of the reason why I became such an active voice against it is it really made me mad that Donald Trump and the people around him were playing them for suckers because, you know, they need the extra $50 that they were giving.
And remember the number one Republican so-called witness against Hunter Biden and even Joe Biden ended up to be a alleged terrorist and by Department of Justice. So there's that too. Speed round time. Let's go to Wisco Paul on the phone. Just got a couple of minutes, Paul. Wisco Paul, go ahead quickly, please.
Well, thanks for taking my call. Nice guest today. And there's lots of Lou's out there. For the life of me, I don't understand why the Republican Party would say, hey, Trump's guilty, and run away from the man and get back to the old Republican Party. That's just my thoughts today. There's just no talking to a lot of these Republicans because right. I know people from Lexington Center, Reedsburg, the Dells, and all over, and there's just a certain number of them. You can't talk to them, and I don't get it. I just move on from the man, and let's get the two-party system back the way it's supposed to be. So that's my take today. Thanks for your show.
Love you. Love your call, Paul.
Here's your answer, Paul, and I'd be interested in your feedback on this if you're still on. You know, you kind of made the point why the Republican Party doesn't do that, because those people are going to stick with Donald Trump no matter what, and they feel like we're going to lose elections if we can't figure out how to run this thin line. And so they don't criticize. And eventually, at some point, those who are unwilling to criticize become complicit in what's going on. Don't you agree?
Yes, to a certain point, but it should be a small percent. You know what? I have very, very dear friends that are Republicans. Some of them have seen the light. Others just never will. I don't know if it's a Nixon hangover or what it is, you know. I don't have the answers for this. I really don't. But there's a certain number. They're going to follow Trump until the very, very end because they don't want to ever – they do not want to say they were wrong. They don't want to be wrong about the man. But it's, you know, the bottom line is democracy's at stake. I said this before at Todd. We're like the shining light, or we're supposed to be, to the rest of the world. And if our democracy goes down here – That's troubling for the whole world. So I guess I'm talking in circles, but I don't understand the concept of sticking behind this guy.
Thanks a lot, Wisco Paul. Don't mean to cut you off, but we're got to get to the break here. I want to get this off the text line quick, Trygve, get your reaction. You were on Friday, but give us your 30-second reply. Derek Van Orten, who swore in front of Senate pages last week, do you think that comes back to harm him next year in the campaign?
I think if Democrats and his opponents can make Republicans be forced to defend the fact that he is, and him answering for how that isn't embarrassing, really good people in the state, third district. But people have to be reminded constantly that he's embarrassing them in the same way that a neighbor who's yelling at "get off my lawn" would.
Let's go quickly. Mark in the sack. I want to get you in. Mark in the sack. You've got 25 seconds. It's all yours. Go ahead.
Well, I think whenever somebody like Lou or CJ accuses people on civic media of lying, it should just be an automatic, like the old shepherd suck coming off and dragging them off the stage, because I'm tired of them calling the hosts and the hosts liars. I mean, it just is not right.
I appreciate it, Mark, but I thought Trygve's answer was great, and it gave him the opportunity to get that out there. So don't mean to cut you off, Mark, but we're up against a break. Thanks for the call, Mark. Always appreciate your support, Mark, from the SAC. Trygve, safe travels. We'll talk to you in a couple of weeks, my friend. Thanks always for joining us. Lincoln Project Senior Advisor. Have a great day. All right, stay tuned next. More on the other side, hour two. This is the Tom Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.